throne was flaming with fire, and his wheels were all ablaze. A river of fire was flowing, coming out from before him. Thousands upon thousands attended him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated, and the books.
Time and rest. forth in the earth. And the trees began to shout with glamour, and their leaves become green. And as the colors of the trees break forth into spring, rise up, O seed. Rise up, O seed. Rise up, O seed. And come alive. And let the glory of your creation come alive.
coming for you to be with me in all that is happening in this hour.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. I'm so proud of all of you being here on time for church. At a time change. Oh, we have a little faith. I woke up praying, honey. I woke up praying this morning that everybody would wake up. When I opened my eyes, I said, Lord, he woke me up. I said, Lord, wake them up. Hallelujah. Good to be home. Good to be home. I came in on that airplane. I said, Lord, I'm so glad you put me in Texas. I'm so thankful that I'm in Texas. Okay. Before I start, I do need to tell you that the Easter brunch here is coming up. And we're passing around, but Sonia's going to send out a website. But if you want to attend, just sign your name, and what we do is we have a table for Eastgate. There's an Easter egg lunch and an Easter egg hunt, so you may, I don't know if you want to sign up for the Easter egg hunt or not, but Gloria, you know, it's $46. You could say that's pricey. It's not pricey for me. I cooked a lot of Easter dinners. It won't take you long to spend $200 to $300 for the Easter dinner together. Yeah. So I go $46. Hey, I'm all for it. And it's beautiful. And it's lovely. And we have a whole lot more than I can prepare. And so I don't cook anymore anyway. I gave that up. Oh, the worship was awesome. Okay, church. I'm going to put y'all to work today. Where's that noise? We got noise? Okay. Yeah, we're okay? Want to be sure we got coming.
It's not the kitchen.
It's not the kitchen.
Huh? It's phone.
Somebody's phone.
We're good. Okay. All right, we're good. Okay, now, this is a prophetic church. Where you don't get to just sit on the pews here. You know, you heard people complain. They're sitting on the pews and they don't get to do anything because they're sitting. Well, if you're sitting on the pews and not doing anything, it's not my fault.
Yeah, that's right.
You should be out there doing something. Amen. Saving somebody, preaching, loving, wherever you go. So it's not your pastor's fault if you're just pew sitting.
Amen.
But today, you've got to go to work. Okay? Every one of you in this church has prophetic gifts. Every single one of you. And I want you to discern what I'm saying today. And then I want you to tell me what the Spirit of God is showing you about it. Okay? I called it sent on assignment because I really didn't know what else to call it.
Good word.
So y'all remember the prophecies that came forth. And this is I only have two listed. So, but there were several that came forth about this trip. Number one, you are being sent to Washington, D.C. Say sent.
Sent.
You will go into a situation that is very chaotic and disruptive. Okay, well, you kind of figure when you're going into D.C., they haven't got it all together, okay? From what we see. Second prophecy that I wrote down. The trip to D.C. is strategic, and the Lord is sending you on assignment. Say sending you.
Sending you.
Do not allow distractions. So as I told everyone last week, I went forth with all seven eyes of my spirit going. And that means wisdom, knowledge, understanding, counsel, mind, and fear of God.
Amen.
Seven eyes of the spirit. Okay. So on Wednesday, I flew in there to change my airplane to go in for the special meeting that I was invited into with Wednesday at 8 o'clock a.m., I'm seated in a meeting room of the Rayburn Building on Capitol Hill as a guest of Dr. June Knight, who is on the board of the Middle East Women's Coalition. Just keep June in prayer when you see her on your Facebook. She is a lamb among wolves. You know, the Word of God says that God will send you out as a lamb among wolves. That's what she is. I will talk more about that later. Okay, a lady by the name of Rabia Kazan is president of this group. Mrs. Kazan travels all over the world exposing Sharia law and the atrocities done to women and children under that ideology. She has the ear of President Trump. And she has, I asked her how many women she had helped out of these Muslim countries, and she said hundreds.
Amen.
So, okay, this was a press conference that I was sitting in at 8 o'clock, leaving Philo home in Texas and arriving in Washington, D.C., and I'm in the Rayburn building at 8 o'clock in the morning sitting at a press conference. The purpose of the press conference was to call for the resignation of Congresswoman Ilhan Omar.
Amen.
Amen.
Democrat from Minnesota. This was in response to Omar's remarks against Jews and Israel.
That's right.
Okay, this group is very pro-Israel. And they are very anti-Sharia law, and they are very pro-life. As well as Omar, which you've already got to know her by now, if you've turned on your TV, refuses to acknowledge child brides and honor killings.
That's right.
Which are done to Muslim women. And I heard the testimony of at least 10 of these Muslim women, or women, American women who have been married to Muslims, and the atrocities that they've suffered.
That's right.
Okay, now mind you, this was a press conference that had been called, but there were only two media outlets there, Breitbart and WATV and radio, which is June's TV and radio. Now, if you go to Breitbart's website or whatever they had, we did find it. He did film all this. The MEWC team gave a short but bold, powerful, I was so impressed with these women, courageous statement, young women. Young women who married to Muslim men in the United States of America, but the Muslim men got their children. We have a situation we've been praying for here in Houston, the same situation. But somehow or another, they control the courts, and the men get the children. So I heard the same thing from these testimonies of these women. After only a few testimonies, protesters tried to interrupt the meeting. And it's on Breitbart. You can see me sitting in the middle of the room.
Blue jacket.
Blue jacket. So I got a blue jacket on. My head is turning in every direction.
Yeah.
If y'all know me, those discerning eyes, we're discerning. So I'm trying to figure out what's going on. Okay. So we got the Capitol Hill Police coming in. So here we have this one group telling, rebuking this other group. And this group is yelling down this group, and the Capitol Hill police come in and they're gonna arrest the disturbing group if they don't leave. Well, they don't leave right away, they gotta make their scene.
Yeah. Of course.
Okay, so finally the police get them out. My head's going, I'm checking this out. See, I still don't know why I've been sent. I've been told I've been sent, okay? If I've been sent, there's a reason I'm sent, okay? All right. So, before I go on, let's go back to the prophecy, more than one, given to me, which clearly places this situation that I'm in, not just a political incident. Do you see what I'm saying? The prophecies I received told me about what I was going into. Now, hey, I'll confess to you, I really thought they were going to release the Mueller investigation. And I would be up there in the middle of the Mueller investigation praying for it. That's what went through my mind. I never, ever even perceived that this situation was going to happen because it hadn't happened yet. See, God knows. So I want to get your focus back to this situation is not just a political incident.
That's right.
But in the kingdom of God, warfare over not just just our nation, but the nations of the world.
Amen.
I've been placed there.
Mm-hmm.
8 o'clock in the morning. In freezing weather.
Yeah.
Yep.
Woo. Just if you know me, that's kind of out of my comfort zone. So, okay, if it were not so that this is kingdom business, why would I be sent?
That's right.
Because I don't just go there to just be going there.
Mm-hmm.
Change my day of arrival to Tuesday in order to be there on Wednesday.
Mm-hmm.
Why would the Lord our God tell me he was sending me into a divisive situation? And I'm thinking, oh, they're going to release that Mueller probe, and I'm going to be up there praying and interceding. And oh, no. God had another plan in mind.
Yes, he did.
So I watched all this unfold before my eyes. I'm praying. I'm just sitting there praying. You can see me. I know Sandra knows what's going on because she saw the video of it from Breitbart. Listen, when you see up in the corner of your television screens Breitbart News, that means this young man that I met filmed that.
That's right.
Now, it might be on Fox News or it might be on CNN, but if it says up in the corner, I didn't notice it before. That means this young man filmed it. He's got some gumption, but he's a quiet gentleman. I liked him.
Yep.
Okay. As I watched all this, I'm trying to figure out what's happening, and I'm pulling on y'all to do the same thing. And I want to reemphasize my admiration for those women warriors.
Right.
They were bold.
That's
I'm sitting there thinking that, you know, what, I can't tell how old people are anymore. If you're 40, you look 30 to me. But they're young, they're beautiful, they're powerful. And they're standing there declaring in the face of this persecution that this evil is evil.
That's right.
Evil. So before the press conference closed, I forget what this lady was. She was a summer group. She was all dressed in pink. I'm talking baby pink.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know what she was, but she's with some pink group. Y'all may know anyway. It's all anti-Israel, anti-Trump. So she gets up and she begins, you know how we stand up and prophesy in a group? So she gets up in the middle of the meeting and she begins to declare and proclaim whatever her ideology is. Of course, the police come in and throw her out. Okay. All right. Now I'm pulling on y'all today, and don't get busy. Okay, following the MEWC press conference, we were advised that Linda Sarsour, now y'all saw her on your television screen this week in the news, if you watched your evening news, was holding a press conference in front of the Supreme Court. She's a Muslim woman with the Women's March movement, supposedly for women. She is a supporter and one of the people who helped Representative Ilhan Omar get elected. She's anti-Israel, pro-Sharia law, and defends her Muslim worldview.
That's right.
Okay. So we get this information, mind you, because we're getting information from the press corps. So here we get in our Uber, and we go over to this Supreme Court. I have on that blue jacket, which is too thin for that weather. I'm freezing. I gotta hold the cameras. Jen's gonna film this thing, because here they all are. Okay, at this press conference that she called, the mainstream media was there in full force.
Mm-hmm.
Every single camera. And you saw it. That night on news, you saw it. I was standing right there.
Mm-hmm.
And it was on Wednesday evening when this broke. And I'm persuaded, that this is what I came out of this, what happened that day. The mainstream media conspired with Linda Sarsour to create and compose this news story, which has been the main story in the media since Wednesday on every channel. This has been the story. Been why? Because on Thursday, after this all appeared on all the evening news on Wednesday evening, Nancy Pelosi introduces Resolution 183. Supposedly, in response to Representative Omar's Islamic Marxist remarks against Jews in Israel. That was what the purpose, that was what they told us it was for. Anti-hate. It's anti-Christian.
Yeah.
I have a copy of it. I read it. I need to bring it today and skim it and give it around. So if you can get it on your computer, Resolution 183. It's composed under the pretense of an anti-hate resolution about anti-Semitism. However, the resolution enforces more division and class warfare. And there's a whole bunch of whereas, like there is in a resolution. Of course, this is not a law, it's just a resolution. But it's set to cause a divide between this nation, between Christians and all of these other groups. Mm-hmm. So they threw all of these other groups in here, but Christians are left out. Mm-hmm. You see, they know where the battle is.
Yeah.
All of these groups are pretty much, not all of them, anti-Christian. Yeah. So it's Christian. What she did in this resolution was set up the Christian faith and left it out against all these other people. I'm going to read one of the whereases to you. Whereas white supremacists in the United States have exploited and continue to exploit bigotry and weaponize hate for political gain, targeting traditionally persecuted peoples, including African Americans, Latinos, Native Americans, Asian Americans, and Pacific Islanders. Remember, what's her name from California? She says she's a She says she's an islander. Her people are from the island. Another purple of color. Jews, Muslims, Hindus. You pronounce that Sikhs. The LGBTQ community, immigrants, and others. With verbal attacks, incitement, and violence. We're not doing that. It's coming
from them.
It's coming from those groups, mm-hmm. not from the Christians.
That's right.
The bill did not condemn discrimination against Christians. Christians are the most persecuted group in the world today.
That's right.
There are nations that you go into and you're a Christian, you can't even go in there.
That's right.
What is more disturbing is all but 23 members of the House of Representatives voted for the resolution. I mean, who would not want their vote when they get ready to run 2 years from now that they voted against a hate resolution?
Right.
So what do I conclude as to why the Lord sent me to D.C. this past week for this disturbance that I didn't even know was going to happen? I had several disturbances in mind. There's plenty up there that I pick. Because the crisis and the story changes daily and even weekly in D.C. But it's done purposely. The media creates the story. They create the story that they put on your televisions for you to see. They create the crisis. The nation capital goes from crisis to crisis, as we know, we watch. The beast system continues with the agenda to divide the nation, creating racism where racism does not exist.
Yep.
That's right.
That's right.
Good job.
There is no racism in this church. I don't even look to see what color you are. I don't
Amen.
Care.
Hallelujah.
I don't care what color you are.
Me either.
I just look at your heart and see where you are with Jesus.
Amen.
The beast is the world system or the cosmos that leaves God out of his reckoning. The mouth of the beast is the liberal media. Mm-hmm. And the book of tonight told me this week that the Lord spoke to her that he had placed her in the belly of the beast. Okay, so if you're in the media, in the belly of the beast, pray for her. She came with her own faith. She sold a little piece of her mother's property to get her apartment. But it was just enough to get her in. She's there on faith from month to month. And I'm thinking, oh, Carolyn, you have a little faith, and I'm just praying. But see, she's got it. She's got the faith. She's got the passion. She has the zeal that she's facing all of this head on. She just marches up there like those big guys with their great big cameras. Someone got this past week. I saw it when she posted. It gave her a $5,000 camera, but there were strings attached to it. Mm-hmm. They wanted to order her to take this young guy in. And I don't know, take care of the guest. Anyway, she couldn't do what the woman asked her to do. So the woman called her the next day, it was while I was there, and told her she wanted her camera back. Mm-hmm. Well, Jane says, okay, got your camera back. So she needs another camera and she needs another computer to get in there and really get the job done right. Shanna said that she's going to, you know, she has a fundraising gift. So she told me she's going to try to raise some money. She's going to try to help with some fundraising for this. So that will be really good. So anyway, about June, I just sit there and look at her and I say, oh, dear God, help her. But she is a lamb. Mm-hmm. Set out there and she does. You know, she just as innocent as she can be, like, you know, who are you? And I'm here, I'm June, my doctor. Well, she has her doctorate, she has her education.
Yes, she does.
Okay, let me go on here. So perhaps I have one more clue as to the mystery of why I was sent into this particular chaos of racial division created and promoted by the mouth of the beast. On Friday, what day would that have been? Day before yesterday. I was again the guest of June and the organization of MEWC to attend the White House, which was one of the original reasons I wanted to go. You can have groups, you can go into the White House now if you go through your congressman. During the Obama years, you know, we couldn't go in the White House. It's only special people. And then there were times when it was being redecorated. Anyway, whenever I was there, I had never been able to go to the White House. Either it was closed or it wasn't for some reason. Okay. When Rabia Kazan, this lady that's over this group, and she's a dynamite, she wants to come to Texas. Oh, she's looking for an old man, by the way, just let y'all know. She told me this. Her English is, I think she's from Turkey. And she's a beautiful, gorgeous woman. And so she first, when she met me, I want to go to Texas. I want to preach at your church. Alan's laughing. And I want to meet a Texas man. I said, how about an old man? Yes. A teeth Sandra. I said, I'll tell about Alan Barley. He's a Texas old man. I used to say that about my husband. My nephew, Jeff Sissom, was still here. One of them worked for one oil company, one for another. And we'd go out with Jeff and Don, and I'd say, I'm going out with Texas old men.
You say
oil
men
or
old men?
Oil. Well, Texas old men. So anyway, I said, do you want him to be a cowboy too? Yeah, I'm messing with her because, if, you know, if I had Texas old man running around here, I'd have women falling out of this place. So, anyway, Gene's a Texas old man. He worked for Exxon.
He's hanging.
Anyway, so they can find out the whole group wants to come here. So I said, I've got to check my schedule. I have to look at my calendar. Anyway, they all want to come. The whole group wants to come. So, anyway, back to my I got there first. She asked me I had on her board as a pastoral advisor. So I assured her, I have a burden for abused women and children,
amen,
or any abused people group.
That's right.
Yeah.
And would serve them as I was able. And, you know, to just let me know how, because I'm going to, you know what I'm going to say. If she calls me about something, I'm telling what the word of the Lord says.
That's right.
Yeah.
So, okay, on with my story here. In the White House, due to the large group and activities, I had not had an opportunity to pray quietly in the White House. These are people who like their picture taken. I've never seen anything like it in my life. They all want their picture. What, you saw my picture everywhere? Okay, line up here, stand here, turn this way. Be sure you're turned this way. I was doing that the whole time I was there. And so I hadn't had an opportunity to really pray. But toward the end of the tour, it was a suddenly.
Amen.
I find myself standing alone from the group. There might have been one or two people milling around, but there really wasn't. There wasn't anyone in that hall with me except one lady. Tell you about her in a minute. But I wasn't really paying attention to her. She was kind of in the background. And it's called the Cross Hall inside the north entrance to the White House. This is the hall with the red carpet they roll out. And when the world leaders come in, our president will be in one pulpit and the world leader will be in another. We've got these two lamp posts beside them and the gold curtains. Okay, that's where I was. And the portraits of the presidents of the 20th and 21st century hang in this hall and entryway. Let me see how much time I got.
All this
time. There was one little thing one of the guards told me that I found very interesting. He said, Obama's picture's not in there yet because they have to be out of office 4 years before their portrait gets hung there. Mm-hmm. And then when the new portrait comes in, they begin to rotate the oldest portraits up the stairwell and on upstairs. Mm-hmm. But there are three that remain and never get moved. One is George Washington, one is Robert Kennedy, and the other is Ronald Reagan. Okay, and I find it interesting, and I haven't had a chance to look it up, as to why Ronald Reagan's portrait is given that honor.
Amen.
Above all the 20th century presidents. But I'm sure glad he has. Okay, back to my story here. I don't want y'all to get off focus of what I'm calling on y'all today. And see, I keep losing my story there. Okay, so I'm standing there, feel the Spirit of God come on me. And I found myself drawn to the portrait of President John F. Kennedy. I felt or discerned, I knew, the presence of a huge angel standing before his portrait. So I'm looking around Reagan's portraits across this way, and George Bush's around the corner. I look and see if they got an angel too, because I'm trying to figure this out, you know, what this is about, why that angel is there. But I'm sure there were angels there. I just didn't discern it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. As the Lord would have it, Barbara Potts, an intercessor of the Capitol of Frederick, who I've known for 10 years, maybe?
Yeah,
10 years. When I go to D.C. And she quickly noticed that I was praying. And she walked up beside me. She was the only other presence in the room, besides a couple of guards standing around. I told her about the presence of the presidential angel. Her first thought was, and she spoke out, President Kennedy was not able to fulfill his commission to end the division caused by racism in our nation. And this angel is waiting to be sent forth to bring peace to end the division. Now remember, the whole purpose of these news conferences differences, and what you saw on your television is to bring racial divide in our nation.
Right.
The whole purpose of that resolution this week that Nancy Pelosi wrote up and got passed in Congress was racial divide over
this
nation.
That's right.
And I'm sensing this angel. And God puts a Washington, D.C. intercessor beside by my side.
Amen.
To help me.
Amen.
Do y'all feel the anointing on that?
Amen.
And she's a powerful one. I know her. She's part of Capitol Hill prayer group, and I don't know what else. So we prayed together in agreement to release this angel to fulfill this mandate that has not been fulfilled since the time of Robert F. Kennedy. But Satan came in and, you know, started killing the president and his brother and Martin Luther King. And then the divide got really bad. Okay, so when we prayed, I then glanced at the other end of the cross hall. Now, I had just come from there, but there was all kinds of people, you know, around. And this is where the president and world leaders stand when they have their press conferences. So out of my mouth, I said, this is the gateway from the kingdom of heaven to the kingdoms of this world.
Mm-hmm.
Not just our nation.
That's right.
The kingdoms of the world come here, and the press from the world come here
mm-hmm.
when their leaders come.
Mm-hmm.
Barbara instantly said, it is a portal. Of course it is a portal. Of course it is a portal.
Mm-hmm.
It has always been a portal. When God established this nation as one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And by the way, if you read Resolution 183, the heading of it is, and I wish I'd brought it, it says that it is an amendment to replace the preamble of the United States, of the Constitution
yes.
of the United States of America.
No.
That's what it says. That's what it reads.
That's what
it says. It reads, this is an amendment to replace the preamble of the United States of America.
No.
Okay, well, here I go again. All right. So between us, you can't go straight down the hall because they got roped off. That's what, and they got the red rug rolled out. You can see part of it. Okay, there's at least a couple hundred school kids now that's filled up the red room, green room, blue room that this hall opens into. So Barb and I have to make our way back down through these children, back to the portal. This great arch in that hall. And when I got down there, there's no time for thinking. For one thing, I've got guards probably watching me by now.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And you know, everything's going on around me. So I stood there and I released two angels. One on either side of that portal, Kingdom of God angels, that when those world leaders come in, that these angels will press on them, and they will not release the agenda of the beast system of the cosmos, that these angels will press on them to release God's will for the kingdom of God.
Amen.
So I released two kingdom angels on either side of that portal. And then I remembered that Obama had declared in another nation that we were no longer a Christian nation.
Yeah.
And then he had stood in that portal. And I stood in the center of it, and I broke the power of the spirit of Antichrist over that portal.
Amen.
Now I had an intercessor with me.
Amen.
She's an eight. Standing right behind me praying. Okay. All right. I do not believe it was an accident that our pots joined us on Friday. When she arrived that morning and first greeted June and I, because June and I were the first ones there, she said, "I find myself in different groups," and I didn't even. She said, "I find myself being invited to different groups, and I'm not even sure who these groups are." Is what she said to me. Spirit of God sent her the other day. There are other meetings which I had in D.C. that I will talk of later, because it's Wednesday night prayer. There are other battlefields that are going on, but I believe this is the one to which I was sent on this trip. I cannot believe it was a coincidence. I was placed in the middle of a battle raging in D.C. that hadn't even happened yet. It was a battle that hadn't come forth because, well, Omar had already been going at it. This lady, I want y'all to remember her name, Linda Sarser. Mm-hmm. Gonna have to remember her name. Because she is set to do evil.
Yes.
She is a powerful figure, got money behind her.
Yes.
And she is the one behind Omar and is set to set into place Sharia law. So Nancy Pelosi cooperates with this.
Yes.
Why did she do that? She set up a resolution which is purpose to be, and now it's not going to pass. I can't believe Senate will pass it. It's not going to come into law.
Yeah.
But set up a resolution, which is their whole purpose, to seat Muslims in a place where they can spout and live their ideology, and it will be a law that we cannot, as Christians, have a different viewpoint. It will be considered hate crimes. Hate crime for speaking in the pulpit. Cannot speak against LGBT, transgender, homosexuals, bisexuals, Muslims, anyone who's attacking our nation, any of these people, we can't speak against it. The whole thing is against Christians. Which we're not.
No.
We're not white supremacists.
No, we are not.
But we're locked in because we're Christian.
Mm-hmm.
Now this resolution passed the House of Representatives while I was there on Thursday morning. And only 23 people voted against it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because they're afraid of Muslims. The spirit of fear.
The spirit of fear. And Nancy Pelosi, she didn't rebuke Omar.
Nope. She's afraid of her.
She's afraid of her.
She's a bully.
She's afraid of AOC, too.
Most bullies, when they get confrontation, they back down and put it in there because she called them at the game. And if she got called at the game, well, she kind of gets somebody that kind of would speak up. But she couldn't stand up for what was right. Period.
Yes. Oh, yes. Okay, I'm going to read you Psalm 37, 8 through 18, and then I'm going to put your gifts to work. Stay away from anger and revenge. This is Passion Translation. Keep envy far from you, for it only leads you into lies. For one day the wicked will be destroyed. But those who trust in the Lord will live safe and sound with blessings overflowing.
Thank you, God.
Just a little while longer, and the ungodly will vanish. Mm-hmm. You will look for them in vain. But the humble of heart will inherit every promise and enjoy abundant peace. wicked keep plotting against the godly with all their sneers and arrogant jeers. Evil ones take aim on the poor and helpless. They are ready to slaughter those who do right. But the Lord will intervene and turn all their weapons of wickedness back on themselves, piercing their pride-filled hearts until they are the helpless. For the Lord takes care of all his forgiven ones, while the strength of the evil will surely slip away. Day by day, the Lord watches the good deeds of the godly, and he prepares for them his forever reward.
Amen.
Okay, Holy Spirit, you have raised up this church. The corporate anointing, a prophetic governmental anointing is over the whole congregation. So Holy Spirit, I ask you to move in this congregation. And I pray that your voice come forth. Bring light into darkness.
Yes, Father.
And Lord, they will be wise, and they will not speak just to be speaking, because they are touching that which you have ordered.
That's right.
Yes.
Pastor Carol, this is a time where God is praised us. Christian circles, and you can see me that no one will bring up the subject of the evil in politics. It's almost like they apply to what's going on around them. But the God always has a remnant. And the word that you had several months ago about the remnant church, we are the remnant. That's not going back down from no lying devils. This church is going to rise up to do great exploits. There are people out there that say, well, you can't buy principalities and powers, but what the word said tells me, Jesus said, whatsoever you buy on this earth will be bound in heaven, and whatsoever I lose on this earth will be loosed in heaven. So the church has to stand up in its power and authority. Christ in us, the hope of glory. We are the persona of Jesus Christ in this earth. And it's time for the church to wake up to see who we really and truly are. Romans 8:19 is going to be manifested. All creation is going to see the manifestation of the sons of God. And we're going to rise up and do the exploits that Daniel talked about. Those who were strong and knew their God, they shall do exploits. And that's us. We're going to exploit the evil in this earth. We're going to reveal the evil in this earth. And an awakening shall come. There shall be an awakening before this is over. And it's where right on the prefaces of this to happen. Time for the prophet Isaiah said, I will spring forth and I will do a new thing. Now shall it spring forth. It's going to be fast. It's going to be sudden. And the enemy's going to be caught off guard. Mm-hmm. Your assignment, Pastor Carol.
Yeah, go ahead.
Because you're an obedient servant of the Most High God, he will always put you in a high place. Because you have the power and the dominion. And he trusts you with his word. He trusts you with your mouthpiece that he put in your mouth.
Amen.
Because you will speak with him. And therefore, he brings you into positions. And some of them weren't very comfortable. But neither was it for the prophets of old either.
Yeah.
And so if we're looking for comfort, you're in the wrong place. But you're in the right place.
Amen.
You're doing the right thing. You're on mouthpiece. In this time of darkness, Pastor Carol.
Amen. Yes, she is.
Amen.
Amen.
this phrase, by your judgments you are judged. And it is not a vindictive thing. God is, you know, accused of being vindictive. That actually kind of, by your judgments you are judged. It does apply to us. It does apply to the unrighteous. It is an application of seed time and harvest. The seeds that are sown spring up to the harvest. That's why you read it, and that's why it's important for us to put away anger and put away envy. Because if those have no place in us, then the judgments against those things that, when people act in anger and envy, the judgments fall on them.
Yes.
We don't need that. So we put away anger and envy.
And there's no place in us for that.
There's no place in us for that. And it's important at this time. The resolution and the other actions that are taken against Christians are taken against the United States of America.
Mm-hmm.
Period. They are simply aiming at us because we stand in the way. Just
that's
as
right.
They are aiming at President Trump because he stands in the way. When they make false accusations, it's obvious they aren't talking about us. So what? Where? How? Where did that come from? They are talking about themselves. They are talking about what they have done. They are talking about what they intend to do. If there's a false accusation against me that I've never seen ever happen, I know that's what's in their heart, the accuser's heart.
That's right.
Yes.
And we have the authority to pray. To pray with boldness, Psalm 37. And this concept that their judgments fall, and by their judgments they are judged. And that's what Psalm 37 talks about. Their swords are shattered, their weapons destroy themselves. They fall into their own pits that they have dug with their false accusations, declaring.
I just wanted to share real quick. I had tried to pull up because I watched you know, online with Dr. June, and she was saying it was HR 183. But what you have to, if you Google HR 183, that's a wildlife bill. You have to put H.res.183. And it'll all come up, the anti-Semitic, or the anti-Semitism as hateful expression of intolerance. It's a very eye-opening document, but they hit it. So you have to make sure you specifically don't put house. You have to put H.res.183. I also want to say, as a born-again Jewish person, a Christian, Messianic Jew, I have met many beautiful Muslim women that live even in Houston. And when they convert, they are, I've met them, their body, their acid is thrown all over them. I know ladies living in Houston covered with acid burns because it is such, it's such a huge ordeal for them to come to know Jesus or, you know, or just the enemy that tries to persecute them. But they exist and they're in the city.
Revealed to me similar thing that Tim revealed, which was our love for God is under attack, our love for country is under attack, and the enemy is using our love against us and all the tools that he has to be able to go in and destroy those areas. And that's what he's doing. He's twisting every area that he can go in and twist and overturn in all these areas.
Carolyn, since I walked in here and I sat down, I felt the Spirit of the Lord all over me. So I think he wants me to share some things he showed me last week, maybe even last September. I came in from a prayer meeting last September, and it was about 2:00 in the afternoon, and Fox News was on, and I saw AOC's face socialism. And the Lord spoke to me and he said, you want to target something? You target that. You target socialism in America, and she's dangerous. That's what the Lord spoke to me.
She's totally demonic.
Extremely. And so anyway, many things have transpired since then, but I think people are getting, they're getting a hold of this, that we're really fighting something bigger than we understand. And so Thursday morning I awakened and went upstairs to pray. And I said, Lord, you know, my spirit is just sick. It is sick of hearing everything that we're hearing on TV. Sometimes it's just almost too much to bear, you know. And I said, what do you want us to pray for? And he said, well, first of all, your president for his protection. Mm-hmm. And then he said, I want you to look up these women that were elected to Congress. And so she was the first one, Omar was second, Talib, and then you have Kamala Harris. I don't think she's quite as dangerous as these three are. And then you've got Linda Sarsour. But as I researched this, the Lord led me to the democratic socialistic movement of America. And this thing was started in 1972 by men, I think the guy that spearheaded it, his name was Harrison or something like that. But anyway, it gave a list of everyone that they supported and got elected. And the first one was, first one was, Walter Mondale. Yeah. Then Jesse Jackson. Then John Kerry. Then Barack Obama. Mm-hmm. Bernie Sanders. And all three of these women. All three of them. So we've got something on our hands that's very organized, very strategic, mm-hmm. and this is how they have taken all of the seats that they took in this last election. And what's interesting is that everyone heard about Keith Ellison, or is it Ellis, this man that was, he was in position in Minnesota, and then he was running for attorney general. Well, the seat that he gave up, that's what Omar was positioned to take that spot, and she was unopposed. And see, they know what they're doing. They're very organized. And so this is what we need to really strategically target.
Yeah. The Lord has zeroed in on it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so, okay.
Yeah, okay.
JT. All right, sorry. Look, I understand what we all are talking about here. So don't take this personal. We wrestle not.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Against flesh and blood.
Yes.
And please forgive me if y'all make a mistake, but look, this is not really a fight for God. This is fear mongering. Is what the devil is doing right now. A defeated foe when he know he's defeated. When he know his time is short, which mm-hmm. the scripture said that he already know. Mm-hmm. This is what he does to cause fear among the weak hearted, the young believers that don't know how to pray, that want to know how to pray. Mm-hmm. The most important thing in this situation, in our situation, is to pray.
Yes.
There's really nothing else that you're going to be able to do, holding signs, marching, all of that stuff is not going to work. From the top down. Now, if you come from the top down where the Lord sits at, where your authority is, what does it look like from that? Everything you guys are saying is true. We really need to focus on prayer. But we wrestle not against flesh and blood.
Yes.
This situation is very easy for the Lord. Mm-hmm. All God is doing is just trying to get his army together.
Amen.
God has an army.
Yes.
And they don't even know that they're in an army yet. Hmm. Flesh is trying to interact with spirit.
Yes.
This is why you can focus on the individual.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
They are demonic.
Yes.
Yes. And everything they're doing is demonic.
Yes.
And he's the defeated foe. Mm-hmm. So we can't allow fear.
That's right.
To cause you to focus on these Democrats and these Republicans that's not saved. You have to keep your heart and your mind and your focus on Christ.
Amen.
Which is the all in all of everything.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I don't mean to take this lightly here, because prayer is the key, is what the Lord is telling me. And the way the Lord is looking at things is that he's an already won.
That's right.
So to interact into this fight that's going on in the United States and how people just worry about taking up all these different seats and everything. Look, if they don't take these seats, Christians just still relax like they were before Trump came president. You see, but now Christians are kind of like, okay, we got to do something. You see, we have to do something. So now Christians know that they have to pray. Why? Because God gave us that mantle. He's still sitting on the throne.
Amen.
And he ain't going to move. Why? Because this is not a fight for him. He given us this thing to pray and to know how to pray and to tell your kids how to pray and to pray for your neighbors and to pray for your presidents and the people in authority over you. Not in a way where you have to love those lost folks.
Yes.
Amen.
Osar, I mean every last one of you have to love them in order to be able to pray for them.
That's right.
Yes, which is what we're called to do.
Yes.
That's our warfare. Alan,
I think Henry was
Pastor Carolyn, this is what I'm going to share what God is showing me about your mission, and I know it's a little bit different than what everybody's been saying. God's mission is not so much about the political issue, but it's about his remnant church that he has.
Yes. Yes.
There's been some attacks against you, mm-hmm. and I'm talking about from a spiritual standpoint.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Many don't know the battles that you've been dealing with spiritually for the last few weeks and months. There's been an all-out releasing of spirits against you and this remnant.
Yes.
You going to D.C. has nothing to do with politics, per se.
That's right.
It all has to do with those dominions, powers. J.T. alluded to. We talk about things and wicked things in high places. That's why you were sent to D.C. One of the things God has showed me. And so what has happened is these spirits have gotten, you know, kind of stirred up and retaliated. I actually see one that has like tentacles and is wrapping itself around parts of the ministry to affect that. Because you made a stand, said no way.
Yeah. Yeah.
And because you made that stand, they are attacking and retaliating and getting jealous and envy and create strife and malice and getting your attention diverted on these other things, these mundane things,
mm-hmm.
while they're trying to tear down the remnant that God has placed in your hands. And so God wants you to continue with the mission, continue to stand. He sent a personal intercession with you to come alongside to help deal with these issues in the room. Yes, it like it was under the guys in the White House and the politics and all this stuff, yes. But God knew what he was doing. He was confounding the people of this world, the foolish things he was taking. I'm not saying the White House is foolish or anything like that. But he takes something like that to deal with the enemy. In the realm of the spirit.
Yes. Right.
Because there's been attacks released, and this enemy is just trying to attack what the spirit's been released, trying to grab whatever he can grab to destroy the remnant that God has placed in your hands.
That's right.
And
that's
if I allow it to, this spirit I'm saying will just create havoc.
Yep.
It's not, but it will create havoc. And you already know what it is. You know, we're not, you know, it's not a person like JT said.
Yes.
Yeah, we know the Spirit uses people.
Right.
But this thing is beyond a person per se, or a group of people.
Yes, it is.
Oh, yeah.
And so this is a remnant that God is preserving. I don't know who mentioned Tim or Wayne talking about a remnant. I mean, yeah, God's preserving his remnant. And so he will get his mission done for you.
Alan, I just want to say something. You know, I want to make sure that there's an understanding that anything that I said was not against a person. You need to know. But what we're dealing with It's not a political war, it's a spiritual war.
Yes.
And so it's very important that we get, we go to the root of it, and we find out, and we stop there. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
First Sandra has a verse.
Yes, I have a verse out of Isaiah 28, verse 5, 6, and I believe it's 7 on the next page. No. In that day, the Lord of hosts will be for a crown of glory and a diadem of beauty to the remnant of his people. We've been talking about the remnant. For a spirit of justice to him who sits in judgment, and for strength to those who turn back the battle at the gate, which this plural right. was the battle at the gate.
Yes.
And you shut that off.
Yes.
Amen.
Just speaking of a battle, back up 1 or 2 weeks, and the Lord was telling me something this morning. I didn't want to get off the subject of what you were, your trip, but I think it has related to somewhat to the portal and those who go through a portal there. But a couple of weeks ago, the Korean summit in Vietnam. Now the results all came back. Well, it failed. Nothing happened. It may be even worse now. But I saw from the Lord that a spiritual missile was released into the bowels of the North Korean regime. We're almost at the completion of 70 years from the Korean War, where much righteous blood was shed and has been crying out. 2/3 of the prisoners of American prisoners of war were killed in prison camp there because they condemned them of war crimes, and they were just soldiers. But this missile that was released into the bowels had a name on the side of it, and it was from the Lord. The battle is mine, not yours. The Korean War is over.
All very interesting, because when I was praying for you, a different thing happened. It's no coincidence that we've been praying and studying angels. So when I was praying, I knew I couldn't touch this particular demonic force that was put upon you. It was too. It was my divine illusion kind of thing. It was very powerful, out to destroy you. So I had to literally call upon the angel of God, and he came, a big guy, and put a chain around this demon.
Okay.
And he just took him out. I have to do that every single day. And even when I'm driving to church this morning, the same thing happened. I said, but she's back, Lord, so I can understand. We still have that warfare. And JT is absolutely right. We have in love, and we have to walk out of fear into knowing who we are in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
And we have to take our authority.
Yes.
It's up to us. He's given us that, you know, sword of the Spirit, and it's just that authority.
The spirits of jealousy, like, who are you? We're talking about the church up there, standing on the wall, doing all the warfare, and like, God sent you over here.
Huh.
You know, I mean, it's really.
That was a major thing you did with pronouncing the decrees that you and Barbara pronounced.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You opened up the portal that was closed because of Yvonne's words, and you canceled them out. And it's just an awesome thing you did. I mean, it's big.
Sissy?
Well, when you were speaking, I just heard the Lord, for you specifically, he said, I don't want to
burst your bubble, but I wanted to burst your bubble. Yeah. I remember a few weeks ago on Facebook, I saw you had written like, all this is happening, but not in my world. And I'm kind of the same way, you know, like we live in this Christian bubble. And so I felt like God just, you know, we see it on TV, but that's still far away, removed yeah. from us. So I wanted to put you in the middle of it so you can see it, hear it, feel it, and experience it, yeah. what's really happening. And I just read Ezekiel 22, and all of Ezekiel 22 is exactly what's happening, you know, this week in America. Of course, it ends with, I sought for a man who would sigh and cry for the abominations. So that's what he's calling you to, that we can feel them, experience them, so we can actually intercede and sigh and cry for the abominations. And it also said in Ezekiel 22, verses 24 and 25, that the land is not cleansed. And it's the land that God wants to cleanse, like with abortion and all this. And it also says in the next verse, there's a conspiracy. So it's all a conspiracy, but the land is going to spew them out because the land is not cleansed and the land doesn't want it because the glory of the Lord covers the earth and it's the land that wants to be cleansed and it's going to spew the evil out because, like you said, the devil knows the time is short. But God says, occupy till I come. So, of course, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but we do have the responsibility to go in there and occupy until Jesus comes. We do have a responsibility and a duty to America where he planted us. And, you know, the first commandment to Adam and Eve was, take dominion of the earth, and we're giving up the dominion. So we have to take our authority and take dominion over our government and over the earth. Even though, you know, the wheat and tares grow up together. But the angels are going to come and gather the tares first and throw them in the fire, get rid of the evil, and then he's going to gather the wheat. So we do get to live in the bubble. We do get to live in the spirit. We do get to live in the wheat. And we do get to live in peace and joy while we're doing it. But we still need to sign cards for the abominations and occupy till he comes back.
Amen. While we're passing that material, something else that I showed you. Trump Tower, the old post office, is built over this area that before it was built was called Murder River Swamp. That was the name of it. You can look it up. And they built, this is where the old post office is, and this is where Trump Tower is. So we went up into the clock, top of the clock, building of the clock, which is in the, it's not Trump Tower, Trump International Hotel, I'm sorry, Trump International Hotel in D.C. It's built over this swamp. It was called Murder River Swamp. This is where, in the 1800s, there was all kinds of murders that took place in the United States. And this is where they dumped the bodies.
Oh my goodness.
And that's where the old post office was built, and which is now Trump International Hotel. So we went up into the clock, up to the top, and I'm sitting right there, and my eyes are focused on the FBI building. And I began to pray that God's justice would be released into the FBI. But you can see from there. I just bleed the blood over the, and broke the power of the murder swamp, or murder river, that building is built over.
Right. Yeah.
Because see, that's still a curse on that land. But I had so much to take care of, I just couldn't take care of everything. Okay, Jenny.
Remember in reading the book Everyday Angels, how Joe Brock went to Paris, you know, on the Eiffel Tower, in position angels, four of them.
Yes.
I believe that that's what you did when you put those two angels in that portal, the White House, I believe is every bit as significant. And I believe they will be there as long as the White House is there.
Amen.
Praise God.
And you need to go, of course you can go. I mean, people are leaving because they have to leave, not because they're
bad. What I really saw in just listening, as you were sharing your message, you shared about what you did, okay? And what you had a discernment of was a president's unfinished business. And what the Lord was saying to me was that we all have unfinished business. because Amen. He's given us dominion, and we need to go in. And you have been a leader, like president. Your leadership is presidential. You could see that angel. You could see and understand what needed to be done about the portal. Every day we go through places, and we need to declare the righteousness and the truth of the kingdom of God through the very portals that we walk through every single day. Because every place on which our feet tread is given to us, and you are a leader with example. You share what you did so that we can follow. But you follow Jesus, okay, by showing, revealing portals so that we see and are sensitive to the portals that we see every day.
Amen. Until I released that presidential angel, it was all like I just turned around and saw immediately the portal. But it was when I released the presidential angel. Okay, here we go. Then.
Kings of this earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointing, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. And verse 4 is the one that I love the most. It says, he that sitteth in the heaven shall have them in derision. And you know, that gives me a kind of giggle, because I think about back when I was young and they had the priest. stooges, you know, when they got in a fight between one another, they were banging each other on the head and stuff. I see that's what's happened with the devils when we set our attention upon the Lord instead of what's going on and say, put them in derision, Lord. You know, that's what I pray against for President Trump as well. When they keep coming at him, I say, Lord, put his enemies in derision.
Yes.
You know.
Yes.
And so,
Psalm 37 says it will be turned back on them. And we're watching that happen.
Yes.
This is what I believe. It's all going to be turned back on them.
Yeah, the devil's stupid.
It's hard, but he's stupid.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. He's really closer to an idiot than stupid. But what, you know, but they always, when your agenda is to steal, kill, and destroy, you cannot win. They will turn around and eat their own selves.
That's yes.
Because they, you know, they're not about like us. You know, if you mess with my brother, you mess with me.
Mm-hmm.
My
they kill their own babies.
Yep, that's right. So they don't care. So
and
no matter what, we can always take comfort knowing that they're gonna fail. You know, because they cannot, they don't have an agenda that can be dealt upon. Period. It's gotta always turn to nothing. All the great guys in the past that thought they were so great, they lost their kingdoms.
Amen.
That's all it's got to be.
Yes.
Anyone got something to say that you hadn't been able to say it? Lori.
I just wanted to share one more thing. I was actually texting with June and I read the bill to you. I read it before, but there's an area where they actually do say in the bill, whereas all Americans, including Jews, Muslims, and Christians, and people of all faiths and have no faith, have a stake in fighting anti-Semitism. Okay, so that's one paragraph, but when you go down to the enactments, it's all about covering the anti-Semitic and the Sharia and the Muslim bigotry. So at the top it said, it looks like, I mean, I can see how people will read this and be like, oh, well, right there. But it's specifically the nine different lists are all against.
When you put it in there, it's...
Mm-hmm.
Okay, church was different today.